In this video lecture, we'll go through a short introduction to the basic concepts of both kinds of looping in Java programs. Okay, let's get started. Before we began looking at selection previously, we started by taking a look at conditions. But before we did that, we first took a look at the four basic flows of control in programming. You might want to take a look back at the diagram showing those four flows of control before proceeding. Looping, then, is the last of the four basic flows of control in programming that we'll consider. Looping simply involves performing the same set of instructions multiple times, but usually upon different sets of data. You might hear looping referred to by different terms in other references or online. Iteration, repetition, while loops, or for loops, for example. But we'll use the generic term looping to refer to all these. There are two basic forms of looping in programming, and we'll examine each one. First, we'll look at event-controlled looping, which is implemented as while loops or do-while loops. Then, we'll look at count-controlled looping, or for loops. In each type of looping, we're performing some set of instructions over and over again, but with one key difference. In event-controlled looping, we perform those instructions, but only as long as some certain loop condition is true. In other words, we don't know ahead of time how many times we'll need to perform those instructions. By contrast, for count-controlled looping, we know going in exactly how many times we'll need to perform those instructions. Just as for selection, in order to implement looping, we need two things. First, we need conditions which express the logic that tells us whether or not to continue looping. And similar to selection, we need the various looping structures which provide us the framework for the statements which are to be executed over and over again. Again, comparing the two looping types, event-controlled looping, or while and do-while loops, are used when we don't know ahead of time how many loop iterations will be required. For example, if we are reading user input from a keyboard, or reading the contents of some text file, we don't know in advance how many keystrokes or text lines there will be, so we just have to keep reading until we're done, whenever that may be. By contrast, in count-controlled looping, or for loops, we know going in exactly how many times we're going to need to execute some set of instructions. For example, suppose the CEO decides she's going to give the same 10% raise to everyone in the company. Wouldn't that be nice, right? HR presumably knows exactly how many employees that entails, so it's just a matter of applying that same 10% raise to everyone's salary in the HR database, one employee at a time, in a for loop. We said we were going to consider event-controlled looping first, so here's a real-world example. A grocery cashier. We all know what happens at the checkout counter of a grocery store, right? We load all the items from our cart onto the conveyor belt, and the cashier performs the same steps all shift long for every customer. First, they reset our total to $0. Then for every item on the belt, they run it past the scanner, make sure that it goes boop, and it gets added to the total. They keep doing this until there are no more items left, at which time they give us the final total and we pay up. But how does the cashier know when they're done scanning items? After all, we generally don't want to be paying for the next person's pizza or red wine. Something, some event, has to happen to tell the cashier to stop scanning items. In this case, the event is that plastic divider bar, you know, the one with the realtor or mortgage broker ads on it, which tells the cashier that this is the end of the current customer's order. The cashier continues scanning items until that divider bar is encountered. This, in a nutshell, is what event-controlled looping is like. We've referred to the idea of pseudocode, right? It's nothing but some free-format notes which help us clarify our thinking on how some program algorithm should execute. It's not executable code itself, but it helps us to write executable code. Well, here's some pseudocode for the grocery cashier example. In sequential order, we first initialize our total cost to zero, then reach for that first item on the belt. As long as that item is not the divider bar, we perform this set of instructions inside the braces upon it. We scan the item, boop, we add its price to the total, then we grab the next item on the belt, at which point we go back up here to check whether or not to repeat these instructions with the next item. As long as that next item is again not the divider bar, we repeat these instructions again and again. We don't know how many items are coming down the belt at us, but we'll keep doing the same three things for each item until we run into that divider bar, at which case we're done and will report the total price and ask the customer to pay up. As you might already be able to guess, this part inside the parentheses represents our condition. As long as this condition is true, we'll make one more pass through this set of instructions. As you can probably also guess, this open and closed curly brace pair represents the loop itself. Taken together, these things represent the general outline of a while loop. In the next lecture segment, we'll start looking at the specifics and syntax of all this in more detail.